Welcome back. Today's story is Mulan from Disney.
The big day had arrived. While Mulan was finishing her chores at home, her mother and I were waiting for her in the village. Fa Li was a nervous wreck.
Of all days to be late, I should have prayed to the ancestors for luck.
Finally, Mulan came riding up on her horse, Khan. Fa Li and I hustled her off to the bather, hairdresser, and dressmaker. Then I gave Mulan some special gifts.
An apple for serenity, a pendant for balance.
I added jade beads for beauty, and a cricket for luck. As soon as the matchmaker saw Mulan, she began listing all the things she didn't like.
Speaking without permission? Too skinny. Not good for bearing sons.
The meeting was a disaster. Creaky, Mulan's lucky cricket, jumped into the matchmaker's teacup. Mulan spilled tea on the matchmaker, and the matchmaker's dress caught on fire when she fell onto a hot stove.
You are a disgrace! You may look like a bride, but you will never bring your family honor!
Ashamed, Mulan sadly led Khan home. She went into the garden and gazed at her reflection in the pond. She thought she was a failure as a daughter. Mulan sat beneath a blossoming magnolia tree and removed her hair comb. Fa Zhu entered the garden and sat beside his daughter.
My, my. What beautiful blossoms we have this year. But look, this one's late. But I'll bet that when it blooms, it will be the most beautiful of all.
He took Mulan's comb out of her hands and gently placed it in her hair. Just then, Chi Fu, the Emperor's aide, rode into the village.
Citizens! I bring a proclamation from the Imperial City! The Huns have invaded China! By order of the Emperor, one man from every family must serve in the Imperial Army.
Mulan followed Fa Zhu into the street and ran up to Chi Fu. She was worried that her father was too old to fight.
Please, sir, my father has already fought bravely.
Silence! You would do well to teach your daughter to hold her tongue in a man's presence.
Mulan, you dishonor me.
That afternoon, Mulan secretly watched her father practice his sword moves. When the exercise caused him pain in the leg he'd hurt in a war, Mulan hurried away, only to argue with him at dinner.
There are plenty of young men to fight for China.
It is an honor to protect my country and my family.
So you'll die for honor?
I will die doing what's right.
But if...
I know my place. It is time you learned yours.
Later that night, I awoke with a start. Something had happened to Mulan. I ran to tell her parents. We saw that she had taken Fa Zhu's army summons and left her hair comb in its place. Mulan had cut her hair, changed into her father's armor, and galloped away on Khan. To anyone, she would look like a son, not a daughter. Fa Zhu knew the law. If a woman pretended to be a man, the penalty was death. I faced the family temple.
Ancestors, hear our prayer. Watch over Mulan.
The ancestors were listening. The first ancestor called for a disgraced little dragon named Mushu, who wanted to be a family guardian again.
So tell me what mortal needs my protection, great ancestor. You just say the word and I'm there.
You are not worthy of this spot. Now, awaken the great stone dragon.
Mushu went outside and hit the great stone dragon with his gong. When the statue broke into pieces, Mushu decided to go after Mulan and make her a hero so he could get his place back as a guardian. He hurried off to find her, followed by Cricky. first thing Mushu did was start a fight between Mulan and the soldiers. The men happily blamed her when Captain Shang appeared.
What's your name?
I've got a name. And it's a boy's name, too. Yes, my name is Ping.
Let me see your conscription notice. Fazu, the Fazu?
Chi Fu, the Emperor's aide, looked suspicious.
I didn't know Fazu had a son.
Training was to begin right away, for the army needed many good soldiers. In order to teach the men both discipline and strength, Shang had them tie a bronze disc to each wrist and climb to the top of a tall pole to retrieve an arrow. Everyone failed, including Mulan. But my Mulan was determined and smart. One night, she tied the discs together and used them to pull herself up the pole. She was the first to get the arrow. The other soldiers began to admire Mulan, especially the huge Chen Po, the tall, skinny Ling, and the short, excitable Yao. They became her friends. Inspired by Mulan, Shang's troops worked harder to improve their military skills, for soon they had to be ready to face Shan Yu, the leader of the Huns, and his attacking army. Throughout all this, Mulan was pretending to be a man. But one night, she sneaked away to bathe in a lake. Suddenly, her friends came running down the hill, throwing off their clothes. Mushu was standing guard.
We're doomed!
Oh, hi, guys. I didn't know you were here.
Mulan ducked behind a rock as Mushu dove underwater and bit Ling. Ling shot out of the water.
Snake!
While he and his pals hopped onto a rock, Mulan escaped. Mushu's trick had worked. When Mulan and Mushu returned to camp, they overheard Chi Fu talking to Shang.
Those boys are no more fit to be soldiers than you are to be captain. Once the general reads my report, your troops will never see battle.
Chi Fu was jealous of Shang, but Mushu had other worries.
I've worked too hard to get Mulan into this war. This guy's messing with my plan.
With Cricky's help, Mushu wrote a fake letter to Chi Fu from Shang's father, General Li. Chi Fu hurried to tell Shang the news.
Captain, urgent news from the general. We're needed at the front.
As the soldiers marched to war, they came to a village that had been burned down. At a battle scene, Chen Po found General Li's helmet. From a distance, the men watched Shang place the helmet on his own sword and reflect sadly. They all knew that Shan Yu had killed General Li. Mulan comforted Shang. Then he mounted his horse.
The Huns are moving quickly. We'll make better time to the Imperial City through the Tung Shao Pass. We're the only hope for the Emperor now. Move out!
At the Tung Shao Pass, Shan Yu and the Huns met Shang's army with a blizzard of arrows. Shang's troops fought back with cannon fire. Soon, a massive line of Huns appeared on the horizon. Shang called out orders.
Yao, aim the cannon at Shan Yu.
Mulan noticed the mountain reflected in the blade of her sword and got an idea. She grabbed the last cannon from Yao and began running toward the Huns.
Ping, come back! Ping!
As Shan Yu galloped toward Mulan and the cannon, Mushu's eyes grew bigger and bigger.
All right, you might want to light that right about now. Quickly, quickly!
Instead of firing at Shan Yu, Mulan tilted the cannon and fired at the mountaintop. The explosion started a huge avalanche. As a wall of snow thundered down toward the two armies, Shan Yu slashed angrily at Mulan. She ran away as the avalanche buried Shan Yu and his army. The snow continued spilling down the mountain. Mulan leaped on Khan and tried to grab Shang, but he disappeared under the snow. Soon after, she found Shang unconscious and lifted him onto Khan. From a ridge, Yao shot a rope to them. Mulan grabbed the rope, but Khan kept slipping toward the edge of a cliff. Yao had accidentally dropped the rope. As Khan went over the cliff, Mulan tied one end of the rope to a saddle and shot the other end up to a friend's. With Genpo's help, the men pulled Khan, Mulan, and Shang to safety. Shang woke.
Ping, you are the craziest man I've ever met. And for that, I owe you my life. From now on, you have my trust.
Just then, Mulan fainted from the wound caused by Shan Yu's sword. The men carried her to the medic's tent. Later, the medic reported some startling news. Qi Fu hurried inside the tent and dragged Mulan outside.
I knew there was something wrong with you.
A woman! Treacherous snake!
My name is Mulan. I did it to save my father.
Ultimate dishonor!
Captain, you know the law.
Instead of killing Mulan, Shang did what he felt was right. He threw down her sword.
A life for a life. My debt is repaid.
The troops left Mulan and headed for the Imperial City.
I should never have left home. Maybe I didn't go for my father. Maybe what I really wanted was to prove I could do things right. So when I looked in the mirror, I'd see someone worthwhile. But I was wrong. I see nothing.
The truth is, we're both frauds. Your ancestors never sent me. They don't even like me. I mean, you risked your life to help people you love. I risked your life to help myself.
Mulan heard a noise. She peeked over the ridge and saw Shan Yu and his toughest warriors climbing out of the snow and heading for the Imperial City. Mulan grabbed her sword and mounted Khan. In the Imperial City, Mulan rushed up to Shang as he rode in the victory parade.
The Huns are alive! They're in the city!
You don't belong here, Mulan. Go home.
Mulan tried to find someone to help her as Shang presented Shan Yu's sword to the Emperor. Suddenly, a falcon swooped down and grabbed the sword out of Shang's hands. The falcon carried the sword to the palace rooftop and dropped it as it flew over a statue. The statue reached up and caught the sword. It was Shan Yu. Below, Shan Yu's men slashed their way out of a parade dragon costume. They grabbed the Emperor and carried him into the palace. When Mulan saw Shang, Chen Po, Ling, and Yao fail to break down the palace door, she hurried up to them.
Hey guys, I've got an idea.
The doubtful Shang stayed behind, but the other three ran after Mulan. She disguised them as women, knowing that the Huns would never imagine that women would fight back. Then, Shang decided to trust Mulan, and they all defeated the Hun guards. With the guards out of the way, Shang burst through the door, just as Shan Yu was about to kill the Emperor. As Shang and Shan Yu fought, Mulan threw a piece of cloth over a rope.
Qian Po, get the Emperor!
Using the rope as a slide, Qian Po helped the Emperor to safety. Shan Yu tried to follow, but Mulan cut the rope. Shan Yu turned on Shang.
You took away my victory!
No! I did.
Mulan pulled her hair back, so she looked like a boy.
The soldier from the mountains.
Shan Yu chased Mulan onto the palace roof.
It looks like you're out of ideas.
Not quite. Ready, Mushu?
Mushu had strapped a rocket to his back, and Cricky lit the fuse. As the rocket sped toward Mulan and Shan Yu, Mulan pinned Shan Yu to the roof with his sword. Then she jumped out of the way as the rocket smashed into Shan Yu and carried him off. Mushu and Kriki hopped onto the sword. The rocket carrying Shan Yu slammed into the fireworks tower. Destroying him once and for all. Later, on the palace steps, the Emperor thanked Mulan and tried to make her a member of his council.
With all due respect, Your Excellency, I think I've been away from home long enough.
The Emperor removed his pendant.
Then, take this, so your family will know what you have done for me.
He gave her Shan Yu's sword.
And this, so the world will know what you have done for China.
Shang clumsily shook Mulan's hand, and Mulan hurried home. She presented the Emperor's gifts to her father.
The greatest gift and honor is having you for a daughter. I've missed you so.
Shang must have realized how special my granddaughter is because he followed her all the way home. And by the way, Mushu earned his place as a family guardian again.
Guess who's back on Pedestal 5?
If you enjoyed today's story, please hit the like button. Thank you for clicking outside reading time. Please like and subscribe. And make sure to hit the bell to turn on your notifications. That lets you know every time I upload. Thank you.